I'm telling you, Bannister, this girl of yours is fun. F-U-N. And if you win that grant, well, you can consider it her victory as well as your own. You follow me?
I certainly do.
Who is that dangerously unbalanced woman?
Howard! Howard! Tell them who I am! Tell them who I am! I insist you tell them who I am right this minute!
I never saw her before in my life.
Keep away the cold, I got steam heat, I got steam heat, I got steam heat, but I can't get warm without your hand to hold. The radiator's hissing, still I need your kissing to keep me from freezing each night. I got a hot water bottle, but nothing I got will take the place of you holding me tight. I got steam heat, I got steam heat, I got steam heat, but I need your love to keep away the cold.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Stuff We've Seen. This is Jim. And now, here he is, the new VP for the Word Police Division of the Sinclair Broadcasting Network, Teal. Teal, I don't know how you do it. You seem to go from gig to gig, and yet you still have time for the podcast.
Well, I gotta say, when I go from gig to gig, I'm talking to people about movies.
Is that it? And it's the Sinclair Broadcasting.
Sinclair.
Maybe you're figuring out ways that they can propagandize the films that they show on their local network TV stations.
Exactly. Yeah. It's all about getting the word out there about propaganda.
Excellent. Okay. So we're going to get right into the show because we've got a lot to cover.
Yeah, we do.
I'm just going to like give people a flavor for what we're going to cover. Yeah. We're going to talk about some passings of some film legends.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to talk about mostly one film that the two of us have recently seen, and then we're going to kind of have a discussion on that entire genre. So get ready for that, kids.
Yeah.
But first,
wait, I have one little tiny thing I want to say.
Okay. Say it.
This just occurred to me. But this movie is in theaters right now. Cold War.
Yes. Well, it's in theaters, you know,
yes,
in select places.
It's in very select theaters. But if you have the opportunity to see this movie, see it. That's all I'm going to say. Just go see Cold War if you have the opportunity to see it. It's really worth it.
Now, of course, you say something like that, and now I have to say something about,
okay,
about it. I, like you, have been dying to see this movie, and of course, you've gotten to see it. I have not. I am in one of those areas that it's not going to show Cold War. It's just not going to, and I'm not going to get to see it. So I already have it penciled in. March 22nd, it will be appearing on Amazon Prime. It's an Amazon Studios film, which is great.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I noticed that the Sundance Film Festival was just finished up, and Amazon Studios was quite busy picking up a bunch of films there, which I guess I'll be seeing on Amazon Prime in the near future.
We can get into this later at some point, but there's a real difference between Amazon movies and Netflix movies.
Well, you did touch on that a few weeks ago, and I would say that the one exception, or maybe, you know, a couple, but...
No, there's exceptions, but...
Roma is the exception where that's their Cold War. And of course, Roma also got a lot of accolades at the end of the year.
Yeah.
But then now here's the thing where I get aggravated is that I want to see Cold War.
Yes.
I know that Amazon Prime has it and they could show it to me. And so I am all for the theatrical experience unless it's not going to be something I can get to. And yeah. then I'm greedy and I want them to put it on right now.
Yeah. So anyhow, go see Cold War if you have the opportunity.
And if I haven't seen it before that, when we get to March 22nd.
We will be talking about it.
We'll talk about it.
Yeah.
Great. But here is a film I was able to get to see because my theater, if they listen to me, and this happens all the time with my theater. If a movie gets nominated for Best Picture, usually they'll book it. Now, Cold War was nominated for Best Director. They're not booking that, but they right. did book The Green Book. And I did get to see it, and we mentioned it on the show. So I just want to give you a quick update that I don't think if it hadn't been nominated for all the Academy Awards, we'd probably even talk about this movie.
Right.
It was, you know, I enjoyed it. In parts, anyway.
Yeah.
The people who take issues with the sort of white-approved version of racial harmony in the movie
right.
I think are well-founded. And it is a film. It's sort of a comedy, a buddy film, a road movie. I do like those aspects mm-hmm. of movies.
Sure.
So that is up my alley. And then, of course, there's the sprinkling of the racial tensions in the Deep South in right. the early 60s. And the film is directed by Peter Farrelly, and he's pretty much noted for outrageous comedy, as with his brother. And they've done, Kingpin, Dumb and Dumber, Dumb and Dumber 2, Something About Mary. You know, that's what they're noted for.
Right.
And this is his first sort of foray into a more serious mm-hmm. comedy.
Is it? I thought he did one other.
Like what? You tell me.
I don't know. Maybe I just, for thought. Some reason, I had that in my mind. But
Hall Pass, I guess, a little bit more serious. Dealing with the potential of a spouse letting the other one get a hall pass. So. Or the Three Stooges, taking a look, a re-examination of the Three Stooges with new characters, which I actually saw in the theater with my son when he was very little. And I had a good time. But it would have been much better with some of his original casting that didn't right. come out. Jim Carrey was supposed to be in it. Sean Penn and Benicio Del Toro.
Okay, interesting.
That would have been brilliant, but it didn't work out. Anyways, so watching this, and I'm already going to be watching with a critical eye because that's how I am, and I'm already a little suspect of the movie. It does take a little bit to get going. I feel like Peter Farrelly was not very comfortable with the material at first.
Oh, interesting.
And he's not really known as sort of a cinematic director. So he's trying, it takes place in the early 60s. It's obviously shot on digital.
Right.
It doesn't look terrible in the theater. Sometimes I find that the movies shot on digital don't look bad in the theater.
But right, but when they're compressed, something weird happens, yeah.
Yeah, so when you're on home, it has a look that's like, it looks very stagey. And then yeah. sometimes in the theater, it's not bad. So I will admit that for a digital period film, not terrible. Again, he's trying to do these sort of Scorsese Goodfellas crane movements and things because it starts at a sort of a Copacabana club and it feels very rough at first.
Yeah.
It just feels so stodgy that I was like, how could this movie even be nominated? But 15, 20 minutes in, they're on the road. And this is where I think Peter Farrelly, does a good job. He knows how to handle comedy situations.
Yes.
He knows how to do that interplay.
Yep.
And what really, I think, holds the film together and makes it a good film is the chemistry between Viggo Mortensen and my wife got really mad at me the other day because she heard the show and I had totally botched Mahershala Ali's name. And so it's Mahershala Ali or Mahershala like Inertia. Which is like an old Saturday Night Live joke when Saoirse Ronan was on. Nobody knows how to say Saoirse Ronan's name, so she made up a song called Saoirse Like Inertia. So I'm using Mahershala Like Inertia.
Okay.
He's quite good. I think he's going to
You're
take
spending
the...
so much time on this, it makes me want to talk more about Cold War, which is actually a good movie that's been nominated.
Okay, well, but here's why this film, and it's because it's been nominated for all of these things. It's got every Deep South, we're in these cities that are not going to be very friendly to African-American. It's got every
right.
trope,
yes.
every hackneyed scenario. You've got
here's the thing. Everything you're describing is exactly what I thought this movie would be based on the poster.
And you know what? You're right. And if you love that kind of comfort, it's going to give it. It's going to give you the Mahershala Ali gets it goes to a bar and gets into it with the rednecks. And Viggo Mortensen's going to have to help him out.
Yep. That scene is basically on the poster.
You've got the them accidentally at night going into a sundown town
of
in
course.
The south. And, of course, getting harassed and put in jail by the police. You've got Mahershala getting into a sort of a nefarious position and also cops and has to be rescued. You've got all of these, every scene that you could imagine. There's also something that kind of bothered me was throughout this film, you know, that he, being Mahershala Ali, cannot go and eat.
Right, right.
In all these white only places. And towards the end, they have a moment where everybody should know that he wouldn't be allowed to eat at this place that he's going to be performing at.
Right.
But they make a scene anyway so that they can have, you know, this other dramatic conclusion.
Right.
Ridiculous. And then at the end, there's like sort of this fun celebration, everybody loves each other kind of thing. And the here's the interesting thing.
Yeah, what's great though is you telling me about this is that now I don't have to see the movie.
Yeah, you never have to see this film.
Yeah,
I did enjoy it. My wife, she had a great time. Like there is, I have.
Oh, I'm sure it's an enjoyable movie. You know, I probably will watch it at some point in the future, and I'll probably enjoy it. But it just sounds, it sounds really expected.
Yeah, there's nothing. I don't think there's anything original in this film.
Yeah, and that's the thing about a movie like Cold War, which is very similar to A Star Is Born.
Okay,
but it does everything in such an original fashion. I got to say, while watching Cold War, there were several times in the movie where I out loud said, "Wow." Just based on the cinematography.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, for those who don't know, again, we've mentioned this on the program before, that the director and the cinematographer for this movie, Cold War, which is shot in black and white, and it's in a classic Academy aspect ratio of 1:3:3, they also teamed up and made this film called Ida.
Yes.
And that is another stunner.
Another masterpiece. Yeah, so this movie was one of the most emotionally involving and devastating movies I've seen in years.
And yet you still haven't seen Roma. So that's kind of the hilarity of this is that, you know, Roma has been available to you for...
I know, but you talked about this, how, you know, the Netflix thing. It's like, well, it's there, so...
I'm just saying that you think that Roma is really... If you liked Cold War, I think you're going to have to take a look at Roma, which is also black and white.
Yeah.
And it's not very conventional. It's really more of a story and dreams and memories of somebody's real life experience rather than a heavy plot driven film. But I have one last thing to say about Green Book. So my wife, you know, she actually got to see it with me. And, you know, I told her about some of the controversies. And one of the controversies is the main writer of the script, his father is who it's based on. His father was Tony the Lip or something. So he's telling the story of this guy's friendship over the years.
Right.
This composer or musician, Don Shirley. And the controversy is that while he's telling this story of overcoming racial prejudices, he was found to have a Twitter tweets that were anti-Muslim.
Oh, interesting.
And so that came out recently because sometimes the politics of...
The politics of the Academy, they try to dig up dirt on each other and destroy other people's careers so they can win awards.
Exactly. So I mentioned this to my wife and she said, that's interesting because one of the things that I liked about the story, and it just shows you how deep-rooted racism is and that it takes a lot to overcome racism on one thing, and you might feel like, oh, I'm no longer racist because I've now I now accept one particular race or culture, but yet you can still be racist.
You can still be racist.
Still harbor racism towards something else, and it just shows you how far we have not come. I think that Black Klansman, which did you ever finish Black Klansman?
No, I plan to. I just
Jeepers Crow. You know, we have a show, but you know, I can't break points because you haven't seen it. Because
but I've seen lots of other stuff.
But you know what's funny is that
I'm gonna watch Black Klansman. I'll watch it before the next show.
Well, then I want to tell you here's why is that I've been thinking a lot about Black Klansman because at first I didn't think it was so great that it should have been nominated for Academy Awards, but now that it has been,
Yeah.
And it's back in the radar screen. And especially after seeing a movie like Green Book, I really thought about the things that Spike Lee does in this film that are subversive.
Yeah.
And that's what makes it interesting, because he takes sort of the buddy cop movie and he pretends like it's a sort of comedy.
Right.
There's more going on, and he sort of subverts it to make some points. So you'll have to see it, because I think a lot of what he does only pays off towards the very end.
Okay. I will see it. I will see it before the next show.
Okay. So, hey, look, we're now, like, you know, deep into the program. We haven't really even gotten into what we're going to talk about. So a couple of quick things. Last week, we had the passing of Michel Legrand. He
yes.
was a French composer and a composer of films. He was 86, and a lot of people probably wouldn't know who he is, but you might know the movies. So he wrote the music for Umbrellas of Cherbourg mm-hmm. with Jacques Demy. He wrote the music for The Young Girls of Rochefort, another Jacques Demy musical. He did the musical score for Donkey Skin, another Jacques Demy film. He did the score for Band of Outsiders.
Oh, yeah, okay.
He did the score for one of my all-time favorite films, the 60s version of Thomas Crown Affair.
Yep.
He did the music for Summer of 42.
Mm-hmm.
Yentl, Atlantic City.
Wow, I love Atlantic City. I haven't seen that for a really long time.
It's a great film, yeah. He did the score for Peter Hyams' Our Time, which we talked about early on
in
one of our early episodes. So we haven't had a Peter Hyams shout-out for a while, but
yeah,
here it is.
But here, yeah, okay. It all comes back to Peter Hyams.
And then he did, in the early 70s, the musical score, kind of a cool, breezy, jazzy score for Orson Welles' F is for Fake.
Right.
At the time, he was commissioned to do the score for Orson Welles' project, The Other Side of the Wind.
Right.
The long-lost, never-finished-completed yeah. Orson Welles movie. So when a couple years ago they started to put together the financing to complete The Other Side of the Wind, they approached Michel Legrand, and he finished what he had started and did the score.
That's so cool.
What was cool about it, I saw The Other Side of the Wind. It's on Netflix. I know you haven't seen it.
you told me not to.
Well, you don't have to rush. It's not that great a movie. It's more of like an interesting curio, because
right.
you get to see a movie that's just being released that was made 40 plus years ago, and you're seeing people that are no longer alive, but in a brand new,
right.
new film. And it has this look of movies that were shot in, like, you know, 16 millimeter,
right.
and, you know, different color stocks that are no longer available. And then this cool musical score. And as I was listening to it, I said, wow, I mean, whoever did this score, I don't know how they were able to make it sound like something you would hear in the early 70s. That's pretty remarkable.
Right.
I went to look it up, and that's when I learned that Michel Legrand came out of retirement to do it.
That is amazing. Wow.
Yeah, so
okay,
he passed
so
away.
He passed away this week. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, I have a story. It'll be quick.
Okay.
So you're right. Unless the audience enjoys these stories, they might.
This is going to be a 3-hour episode.
No. We'll trim if we need to. So a couple of days ago, my wife was reading an article, and some filmmaker was talking about being influenced by certain 80s films.
Okay.
And Explorers, the Joe Dante film from 1985, yes. was one of these films. And my wife says, Explorers, you've seen that, right? And I stopped right there. I said, you got to be kidding me.
Yeah.
You grew up in the 80s and loved, like, you were like the prime age for a movie like that, and you never saw it? How could this be? She had never seen it. So we looked, and it was available for free to watch on some, you know, demand.
Right.
So we watched it over a series of two nights.
Quick shout out to Joe Dante while we're here. He had quite a run in the 80s.
When you think of these 80s movies, and I know there's a lot of these people up there talk about, you know, Stranger Things and those filmmakers, the Duffer Brothers or whatever they are.
Yeah.
They talk about their influences. Everybody loves to throw out the word Spielberg. What they're really also being influenced by is Joe Dante.
Absolutely. Yep.
You know, when we're not going to do a program on Joe Dante, but here's the part of the story that was going to get to it. At the very end, they're showing different actors that were in the film and kind of put their name to the face. And I was lamenting how it's kind of sad that two of the actors, one is Amanda Peterson and the other being River Phoenix, are no longer with us. And I said it was weird because there's Dick Miller and he's 90 and he's still around. So we finished the movie and not 10 minutes later, I look on my iPhone and there it is. Dick Miller passes away at age 90.
At age 90, yep.
And we just finished watching Explorers, and I was like, wow.
Great Dick Miller moment in Explorers.
One of the fascinating things, and I've seen this movie a ton of times, and then I've done some research on it because it leads me, as I was older, I could see not the flaws, but that there seemed to be loose ends not tied up.
Yeah.
Dick Miller is an interesting character where you kind of find out that he has experienced the same dreams that the kids have had.
Right.
And that somehow these kids sort of unlocked the code because they were into computers and science and they got called on, where he sort of had this regret all his life that he got messages that he couldn't fulfill.
Right.
And his last moment on screen in Explorers, he sees them sort of flying off and he kind of salutes them, sort of like, good going, kid.
That's the moment I'm talking about. Yeah.
And what I like about it is that most films like this, there would be a lot of the man, like the government or the police,
right,
sort of after the kids. And here's a guy, he is part of the police, and he sort of first spots them in when he's in his helicopter, and they're doing some trial runs with this technology that they've learned that's going to get them, you know, potentially outer space.
Right.
But instead of him like busting the kids or becoming a main antagonist, he is misunderstood by the kids. He wants to share their dream, and he wants to help them if possible. But they don't. They kind of are afraid of a grown up, so they leave. And then you don't see Dick Miller ever again, even at the end. And here's kind of the sad story. I didn't think we were going to talk about this, but you know, our show, you never know. The film has a feel to it that's a little uneven at times, and maybe not 100% finished.
Yeah.
That the ending isn't quite what you might expect a film like this to be. So when the film was in production, Joe Dante said that there was a producer shakeup.
Right.
And the producers wanted to see what they had. Originally, they had like a sort of a 3-hour rough cut of the film.
Okay.
And they were suddenly pressured to finish up and get us a rough cut we can look at. And so he did, and they kind of shortened it, but they hadn't really fine-tuned everything. And the producer said, oh, this is great. We want to get this out for summer, so you're going to have to stop there. We're like, but we're still editing. Nope. Not going to be any longer. And you're going to make this.
Okay, wow.
And then all the footage over time has been lost. And so Joe Dante really kind of, when you bring up Explorers, he has that very regretful feeling that the finished film is not the movie that he thought they could make.
Right.
And that they were still working out kind of how this movie could be greater.
Interesting. Okay. So I just realized we're talking about Dick Miller, but we didn't really say who Dick Miller is, and a lot of people might not know.
Dick Miller is a character actor, and he was in Explorers. How you probably came to him, and I came to him, was that Joe Dante used Dick Miller as almost his Hitchcock cameo.
Yes, and I discovered Dick Miller through Joe Dante, and then I started digging into the Dick Miller filmography a little bit, right? Because, I mean, he's a really interesting actor in a way. He has 182 credits on IMDb.
He was a guy who worked.
starting in 1955, and he's got two things that haven't come out yet.
Really?
Yeah. One is a short, but yeah, he I see, yeah, he's got some stuff still coming. So he worked like crazy, and he started off with Roger Corman.
And so many of these people did. So did Joe Dante.
And so did Joe Dante. And that's the thing, is that a lot of the Corman people, the sort of Corman school people who came out of that, liked Dick Miller and put him in stuff.
Well, I think he just seemed, and again, I never knew the man, but he seems like a nice guy.
He does seem like a nice guy. Okay, here's my two favorite early Dick Miller movies. Really early. Rock All Night.
I don't know that one.
From 1957, directed, of course, by Roger Corman. And then, of course, A Bucket of Blood.
And, you know, if you had said this to me 2 years ago, I would never have heard of Bucket of Blood. But I caught it on Turner Classic Movies. And because it's so short, it's only like 65 minutes.
Yeah.
Easy watch. That's a great movie.
It's a great movie. It's on Amazon Prime right now. It's a cult film. I mean, you know, it's not for everybody, but yeah, it's a great little movie.
Well, first of all, it has that very sensational horror title, but don't let that fool you. It's really not a scary movie.
Not at all.
It's basically Dick Miller, and this is really one of his few starring roles. He's like, what, the dishwasher or something at this hip beatnik club.
Yeah, he's the busboy at this super hip beatnik club, and he really wants to fit in, but all the beatniks make fun of him all the time, and he's like, I can do it. I'm going to be an artist.
Yeah, and it's almost, you know, it's weird. In a way, it's the exact same formula as another Roger Corman classic, Little Shop of Horrors.
Yes, yes.
Where he accidentally kills somebody. And to cover it up, he dips him in like plaster of Paris. And what happens is, and it's sort of a funny critique of the art world, all the beatniks think he is the next great artist.
Well, okay, but first, he accidentally kills his cat.
Oh, I forgot about that. See, I haven't seen it as recently as you have.
Oh, it's a great... His cat is trapped in the wall. And so he tries to cut a hole in the wall to get the cat out, but stabs it instead.
This movie is really outrageous. And again, let's let people discover it. I mean, if you don't have time for an hour on Amazon Prime, then, you know, whatever. But I think you should discover it.
Yeah.
So in the 80s, he seemed to find, with Joe Dante movies and everything else, he always seemed to be at the center of the action in a key scene.
Yes, exactly.
So, for instance, in The Terminator, he's the gun salesman in that very famous scene.
Right.
And in After Hours, he is the owner, or like at least the manager, of this After Hours diner.
Yes.
Down in Lower Manhattan. And he is kind of coins the phrase After Hours.
That's right.
Basically allows the two of them to have their coffee for free. And he says, forget about it. It's After Hours. Different rules apply.
That's right.
And he had a really like this great face and a great voice.
Really incredible face. Really an unmistakable face.
But I mean, everybody remembers him from Gremlins. And he's also in Explorers, The Burbs, The Howling, Small Soldiers, like every Joe Dante movies. He's in every single one.
Also, I think another guy who came out of the Corman School, Fred Decker, he used to Dick Miller also.
You know, here's just our little salute. Like, he meant something to us having grown up in the 80s, you know?
I really loved him in the 80s. And, you know, anytime that Dick Miller showed up in a movie, I'd be really excited.
Lately, it seems like there's this nostalgia.
Yeah.
For the 80s. So this may have to do with, like, the newer crop of filmmakers coming up. And I'm talking about not necessarily people that even, like, were born in the 80s. They just have this appreciation for the films of the 80s. Some of them have childhood memories. And so we're starting to see an influence. And I mentioned Stranger Things, right?
Yes.
Set in the 80s. Everybody's like, you know, fascinated. My oldest is fascinated with the 80s because just probably the way I was fascinated with the 50s and 60s, these were not decades that I could understand.
And the 80s is, in a lot of ways, the 80s has more in common with the 50s than it does now, right?
Yeah.
It's the 80s was the end of an era before the information age, basically.
The 80s, kind of because it's right before computers took over and technology.
It's right before cell phones and internet.
If you set a film in the 80s or story, you don't have to worry about some of the communication issues that are solved by smartphones.
Yeah, and the movie I was talking about the other day is Pete's Dragon, the newer... the remake of Pete's Dragon by David Lowery, who's a director I really like, by the way. But that's set in the 80s, and if people had camera phones, the movie would not work. The entire movie would completely fall apart.
Yes.
And so it has to be set in an era where people don't have cameras in their pockets.
Correct. So why am I even mentioning this, right? Because...
we watched a movie.
We watched a movie that is set in the early 80s.
Yes.
And I feel that because while we both wanted to see it, as a matter of fact, I think I mentioned to you, hey, have you seen this movie?
Yeah.
And then you jumped on it right away. And then I saw it afterwards because I felt like I had to.
Here's the thing. I had actually started watching it.
Oh, you had?
Yeah. I'd started watching it maybe a month ago or so.
Oh,
and
now this is news to me.
Yeah. So here's my little story about it. It was late at night and I thought, you know, it to me, it was, I didn't know much about this movie. The movie we're talking about is called Mandy, starring Nicolas Cage, directed by Panos Cosmatos. And I saw the cover, Nicolas Cage's bloody face. I thought it was just going to be another Nicolas Cage movie, which sometimes are pretty fun to watch, right? I like Nicolas Cage. So I started watching this movie, and it was really weird at the beginning.
Yeah, in the beginning. Through the beginning and the middle and the end. But yes, the beginning is a very strange vibe.
I got about 10 or 15 minutes in, and I was tired. It was really late at night, and I realized this movie requires more attention than I am capable of giving it right now. I was expecting just another, like, you know, B movie that wouldn't require me to think or pay attention or put any work into watching it at all. This movie demands something of the audience. And so I turned it off and came back to it a few weeks later and started from the beginning.
And was it based on me saying, had you seen Mandy?
Yes, it was. And so I realized, okay, I'd already started watching it. I wasn't sure quite what to make of it. Started it over from the beginning. Watched it all the way through in one sitting, of course, because I don't think you can do this film in another way.
This is a one-sitting film.
This is a one-sitting film. It's, there's so much to say about this film. I'll give the story away right off the bat.
Not too much of it.
Well, no, I'm going to give the whole thing away. It's a revenge movie.
Yeah, that's all you have to need to know, right? There's a couple things. There's the revenge movie. That's a genre.
Yeah.
It is definitely a genre people love. And then within it, there's sort of, you can break it down into various subgenres of different types of revenge films.
Exactly. Yes, it's a revenge film, and it follows that basic structure. All of those films have, every revenge film has the same basic structure. And the way I'm thinking about this, like working in a genre like this, is there's certain notes you have to play. But like jazz, it's the notes you play in between the notes that make it something unique. So there's a lot of revenge movies that just hit the notes. Mandy plays all the notes in between those notes.
Sure. You could count like about 50 different revenge movies.
Yeah.
But kind of like to fall into the classics category, you got to take all the things that the revenge movie does and that appeal to people who like revenge movies.
Yeah.
And then you got to do some different things with it, because ultimately the revenge genre, it is a very basic plot.
Yes.
There really isn't much difference. Obviously, something happens and somebody's going to have to take revenge. Yeah,
something bad happens and somebody takes revenge, and either they succeed or they fail. Yeah.
So that's where, you know, after you see a bunch of these, you're looking for somebody to do something to elevate
Yes.
the genre.
And Mandy, to me, really elevates the genre. There's a few things that it does. One is, in all revenge movies, you have the normal world before the horrible, violent event happens. Right? So you have this sort of peaceful world that's about to be disrupted. The peaceful world in this movie is really interesting. It doesn't hit the normal beats, and it establishes a relationship in a way that I haven't seen a revenge movie do, and that it gets you really emotionally involved in really creating a real character, not just somebody to sort of kill off and manipulate the audience, but it's somebody we actually become really invested in. And so we do really, and we buy the love and the motivation of the main character so much that we emotionally buy into the through line of this movie. And I think that's a big part of why it works on a foundational level. Then on top of that, it does so much crazy stuff. This is such, in a way, an over-the-top, crank-it-up-to-11 kind of movie. But it maintains this really solid emotional core, which allows it to go in all these crazy directions.
It takes it to 11, and then it turns even further and breaks the knob.
Yeah, I would say it like throws the whole stereo out at the end of the day, right? Like,
you know, sometimes we go to these dark places. This is not a movie for people who are looking for a comedy. It's, you know, there's a lot of blood and guts and gore.
Yep, this movie is not afraid to linger on gore.
And that's where I think people are looking at it is, well, it's set in 1983, but they also feel like it's a throwback to these crazy, low-budget, just almost exploitation
movies. Oh, they are, yeah. They're like midnight movie exploitation flicks.
Mandy, this film, it's interesting because even the villains in this movie, they're not just some cardboard cutout villains.
Right.
They are kind of have interesting characteristics. You don't root for these villains.
No, not at all.
They're actually written well, and you don't just get these like awful people that you can't wait to get killed off in the end of the film. You just get interesting characters that start to work on you and say, this whole movie, man, is not like the typical film that I would see in a revenge film.
Yeah. And so there's like sort of like two groups of villains in this movie that are connected. And I have to say, the villains in this movie, you know, I watch a lot, as you know, I watch a lot of movies. I can take quite a bit. I have pretty good emotional armor for movies. But these guys creeped me out. There were moments in this movie where I was like, oh, wow, that's creepy. That's kind of scary. Like, it unsettled me. It unnerved me a little bit. And I wasn't, that's hard for a movie to do to me. But there's one group of villains in this movie that was really creepy to me. Actually, both groups of villains were, but in different ways.
Yeah, I mean, this movie, and, you know, here's the thing. We're trying not to give away too much. We've already told you, it's a revenge film. So Guess what? If you go into this, you know that there's a couple that are in love, and bad things are going to happen, and revenge needs to take place.
Yes.
There's the plot. You don't need to know anymore. We're just trying to say that within it, there are some unusual things that make this film weird.
Yes.
And when it starts to go over the top, it goes to places that you don't necessarily see in movies today. And it becomes a bit of a thrill ride. When I watched this film, which I watched at home, I kept thinking, man, I would love to see this movie with a packed midnight crowd.
Oh, absolutely.
There would be energy in this film like you wouldn't believe, people getting excited because
the film is so emotionally engaging.
Well, when the shit goes down in this movie, I was on the couch going, yeah. And my wife was on the couch going, yeah.
But that's what I'm talking about with the emotional through line, right? Is that first hour sucks you into that. And I was sitting there going, when is the revenge going to start? Because I can't wait to see these guys go down.
That's a good place for me to jump in. I want to start by saying that I loved this movie. It's definitely one of my favorite films of 2018.
Yep, me too.
But
I'm not recommending it to anyone.
Well, I'll recommend it to people I know who can handle it.
Yeah.
However, that doesn't mean that I didn't have some issues with the movie.
Right.
And I feel that, you know, I would only invest the time in a movie I really, really loved to pick apart some things.
Right.
And most of it was how it kind of started. It was pretty clear that the kind of feel that the director was going for was this early 80s, not necessarily grindhouse movie, though that can apply, but these exploitation films that he himself as a boy loved to watch.
Yeah.
And those films were made on a shoestring budget, and they would be with, if they were 35, they were films that probably were shot kind of grainy on fast stock because they just didn't have the lighting for
exactly.
it.
Exactly, yeah.
So those movies tended to be grainier, and because they were working on such a low budget and film was expensive, there wasn't a lot of film to go around. So these
to be very economical about how they set up their shots.
Yeah, which means you have to, you know, you have to do a lot of planning.
Yeah.
And get the right coverage, and you may not even get the best take, which is sometimes why I think some of the acting is not so good because you don't have the luxury.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So that all kinds of creates an aesthetic, and for me, the thing that first started to take me out of this is, it actually says 1983.
Yes. Right?
And there's even a shot of Reagan on the TV.
Yeah. Okay. I have to point out, I know where you're headed with this. On the front page of the screenplay, on the title page of the screenplay, it said under the title, this film is presented in 16mm anamorphic.
See? So even with the screenplay, at which the director is a co-writer of.
Yes.
His thought process was to go in that direction. Now, things in the industry have changed. And film is more expensive than ever because it doesn't get used as much. So it's not a money saver to do film because It cost a lot
more. It cost
more,
yeah.
In the labs, etc. And this is a low-budget movie, and so that just became right out.
Yeah.
And but here's my problem, is that to make up for that or compensate it, he did shoot it in an anamorphic look.
Yes.
So that part has the sort of the throwback feel. But they put filters on the digital, you know, After Effects.
Yes.
Filters to give it a grainy look.
Yeah.
And when they do that, it does not look like film. And I know
no, it doesn't look like film.
But producers try to convince people that it does look like film, and it does not.
Yeah, it didn't look. Okay, so I had this exact same issue with the movie. And I basically decided I had to give up on being bothered by it in order to enjoy the movie, because he does some things with digital. Yes, the grain looks like it's just placed on top of an image instead of part of the image. But there's a lot done with the photography here that's interesting in terms of contrast, lens flare, the way the light works, that's different than how it would work with film.
But see, that's what my problem was, is that the film was successful for me when it was abandoning this idea to make it look
yes.
like. So it's two schools of thought, is that when he did abandon it, there were things that digital can do that film can't.
Yes.
And on a low budget film like this, it enhanced.
Exactly.
My thought was, drop this notion, make it its own thing. And quite honestly, you know, you brought up the cell phones. There really isn't anything that happens in this movie that a cell phone would change. And so,
well,
I
except,
think it would have been, no, not the way that this film was. I mean, this was a film with little dialogue from the main protagonist.
Right, and, but there's a sense of isolation in this movie.
Yeah, but I think because it was taking place somewhere in the Northwest,
right.
That I think would have been more interesting is if they didn't put references direct to like 1983 and even that Reagan thing. And,
right.
But yet, if there was cars or anything, make people have to work for that. Say, what does this movie take place?
Right, and don't just come out and say this is 1983 at the beginning of it. No, I agree.
Because then the whole digital film thing is cleared up. There's a movie that we have not talked about on the show before. It is also, like, had a razor-thin budget. And it is called The Love Witch by director Anna Biller. Much different type of film. However, she had a vision as a director that the movie, even though it wasn't necessarily, it was set in modern times, there's modern cars, there's actually cell phones.
Right.
She wanted to have a look of these low-budget films from the early 70s and have that sort of, like, film stock that almost doesn't exist anymore. And
right.
Part of the reason why is that the way films started to be made after the early 70s, they switched to different lighting schemes, so things weren't as harsh, wasn't
yeah.
the studio look. She wanted things to look like they were on a set. She had costumes designed to enhance that deep, rich
right.
color. And she found a cinematographer who they not only shot it on 35mm film, but he knew how to do that harsh, high-key lighting
okay.
to get this Technicolor look. And when I saw this first on home video or whatever,
right.
Demand, I thought, wow, this movie's sensational. Like, how are these colors are so vibrant?
Right.
Like, this looks like film and even beyond, and it was. Then I got a chance to see it in the theater 2 months later, and it not only was the movie shot on film, but they actually had it printed on film.
Oh, they projected film.
The movie was actually... nowadays, you would never touch the negative.
Right.
You just have the, you have it digitally processed.
Yeah.
So even if the movie was shot on film, there's some kind of digital.
Oh, the whole thing is digitized straight off the negative. Yeah.
But not The Love Witch. It's cut. The negative is cut and the prints were struck right off the negative.
Wow.
Very few prints, obviously.
Yeah.
But when I saw this thing in the theater, it looked like I was seeing a vintage print
yeah.
from 1974.
I agree with this issue on Mandy, and I also really agree that it shouldn't have put date stamps on anything. It should take place in its own little world, that the less connected to our world, the better. So I agree, that is a little bit of a flaw with the movie.
So I was kind of, because of this, and I was a little distracted at first, because I was like, well, if he's really trying to do that early 80s thing, I wanted it to be all the way. I wanted it
right.
to feel like we might have found this film in a capsule other than the actors and actresses.
Yeah, and it definitely doesn't have that feeling.
But we put that aside for a second. It does take a while, as you said, like you watched 15 minutes of it and you put it aside.
Yeah.
It starts off slowly.
It starts off very slowly.
Because there's not a lot of dialogue even in the film at the beginning.
No, and the dialogue there is kind of quiet and not really dramatic. There's this one shot of the two of them where it's slowly moving in on them and she's talking. And it's a great moment, but it's a little hard to focus on because you're like, where is this going? And this just takes so long and it's so slow. And
well, that's, I mean, I don't, you know, it's funny is that I don't mind it. I mean, the movie was 2 hours.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, I've said this to you that I feel like it should have been 95 minutes, but mostly because, again, if you're honoring that early 80s thing,
yeah.
the time it takes at the beginning is too long in terms of this genre. It is what it separates it, though. So if you can get exactly. past the fact that it takes a while.
And I would argue that the fact that it takes a while, it lays a lot of the emotional groundwork for what's to come.
It's true. Because then you do get really caught up and you really...
Exactly.
It's funny. It's not that you care. You're just invested in their relationship and then what happens.
Yes.
It makes you even more invested in the revenge factor.
Exactly. And so many revenge movies, I feel like, write off the victim early on by just kind of giving them some bland introduction and like, oh, we're in love with them. And then they, you know, get killed or whatever. This movie really invested in it in a way that I haven't seen it. And yes, maybe it takes a little bit longer at the beginning, but it also gets you into this mindset of this movie and this feeling of it. And like I said, you have this anticipation. You know what's coming. You want it to come. And then when it does, it's so satisfying. And I think part of that is the long buildup. The long buildup is also turned up to 11. Like the whole movie cranked up everything. And even though it's quiet, it's not loud, it's 11 in terms of the pacing.
Part of the story, it kind of involves an important ingredient, which is sort of this psychedelic drug
yes.
that's in the film. But not only, you know, is there this psychedelic drug in the film, literally the movie suddenly feels like it's on the psychedelic drug.
Oh, absolutely, yes. This is a psychedelic, surreal... I mean, it's really hard to describe the amount of style in this movie.
When I was having problems at the beginning, when that started to disappear for me is when the action... We'll call it the action, but when
yeah.
the incident happens, the things they do there... And I've seen a lot of these revenge
yes.
dramas. It is different.
Yes.
And I think of a lot of these revenge movies, there's usually some really awful thing, and it's very quick and sort of painful. You know,
yes.
we talked last week when our guest Bill was there, you mentioned Death Wish 2, and that was the sequel to this whole kind of revenge drama.
Yeah.
And there are these moments which set the protagonist on their journey for revenge, and they usually are upsetting and almost on purpose to make the audience as upset.
Yes. No, the audience has to be angry enough that they will support vigilantism, basically, right?
Yes.
You have to make the audience emotionally complicit in the revenge. And in order to do that, they have to be really invested in the initial incident, emotionally invested in that, and have enough anger at the perpetrators to sustain the rest of the film.
There's something, and this movie, this is why this movie is so great. It just got me thinking about so much and reevaluating the revenge
yes.
genre and thinking a lot about most of these films, not all of them, and maybe we can mention a few that aren't, but most of these films are driven by a male protagonist seeking revenge.
Yes.
And they are directed by men. And a lot of times there's violence or sexual violence against a woman related to the man. And in a weird way, it feels like, you know, these male directors, there's some kind of like either deep, dark fear or some kind of weird fantasy about the person they love or the people they love being harmed and then having to try to get revenge.
Yeah. And it feels often like revenge movies often feel like male fantasy of protecting a weaker woman, basically, who's been harmed by men most of the time.
Yeah, and sometimes some of the interesting ones, and I think this is one too, is something I like to call is the emasculated male.
Absolutely.
There's ones where not only is the violence happening to loved ones, but violence happens to the man as well.
Yes.
They're usually put in a position where they are incapable of fighting back.
Exactly. They're tied up while their family is tortured and killed, and then they're often left for dead.
Yeah. And you know, that's one, it's the flaw where you feel like, well, why is this man left for dead? Oh, because right. he has to have his revenge. But again, this movie made me think there's a little psychology. They're left for dead thinking they will die, but that this group wants to torture the protagonist even more by saying, we have just done something awful to your loved ones. You've had to watch.
Yes.
And now you will die thinking about this and grieving while you die.
Yes, while you bleed out.
It wouldn't be a movie if the protagonist didn't live.
Yeah.
But I was thinking of films like the first Death Wish. You know, here's Charles Bronson was a character actor that was a tough guy.
Yes.
And all the movies that he had been in were, you know, Westerns or what have you, where he was a real macho guy, took care of business. And along comes Death Wish in the early 70s at a time in New York where there was a lot of violence, a lot of street violence happening.
Yep.
People were afraid. His character's name is Paul Kersey. He's an architect with a wife and daughter, seemingly the perfect life, living in an apartment on the upper west side of Manhattan. And then a group of punks break into his apartment.
80s punks.
Yeah, well, this is 70s
punks. Oh, 70s punks, okay.
They break into the apartment and they kill the wife and they rape the daughter. And where he's the emasculated man is, here's a guy who's played by all the rules. He's providing for his family. He's not a violent man. And
right.
he wasn't around to do anything about it. And there are no suspects, no leads, nothing he can do. He is powerless. And so he acts out and becomes a vigilante.
Yes.
And not necessarily to get revenge on those particular people because he doesn't know who they are.
But he's enacting his male rage. What would I do? How far would I go to protect my family?
And, you know, there's even the very popular John Wick series. That's a movie where it doesn't really waste a lot of time.
Well, that's what...
It gets right into things.
It gets right into things. And that's what I was initially expecting from Mandy. But I actually really like that it didn't do that.
You know, the movie that I thought a lot about when I was watching this was a film that I actually saw for the first time maybe a year ago, was Rolling Thunder.
Yes. Oh, you just saw that the first time a year ago?
Yeah, I'd heard about it, but I was had to see it.
Oh,
and
okay.
It was a movie that I had to watch kind of in installments just because of that tough subject, you know.
Right, right, right.
Where he is a Vietnam POW who's just returned, so it's...
You know, it's interesting you mention that because you could actually do a whole, I think there's a subgenre of returned Vietnam vets and violence.
Yes. So it's these characters they've experienced violence and torture and all these pains
yeah.
in a war that many people didn't understand. And now they come back to the States and they are subjected to more violence.
Exactly.
And that's what happens to William Devane's character. His wife is going to leave him because he was a POW for years and she fell in love with his one time best friend.
Yeah.
And so that's already emasculating enough that he is mentally tortured from his time in
yes.
Vietnam, being a prisoner of war. He's not really able to take care of his wife. She's leaving him. And then muggers, these sort of awful kind of shit-kicking Texas hombres guys, they break in to rob him. And his will that he experienced of not giving in to the Viet Cong comes into play, and he won't just give them what they want.
Right.
And so they are going to torture him. But at that time, his wife comes home and then his son from a baseball practice. And in front of him, they murder them. And that's just it's a very brutal
yeah.
scene. And then on top of that, because he has been pinned down, and he can't save them any more than he could save himself when he was in Vietnam. They stick his arm and they put his hand into a garbage disposal. And they take away his
yes.
hand.
Yeah, okay.
It's very brutal.
Oh, you're going all the way with this. Okay, keep going. Yep.
Well, with this one, I mean, I don't want to spoil Mandy, but like it was, you know, it was jarring. But now this guy, his revenge, I just thought of the fact that he had to witness this event and he had already been through so much. And so his only purpose now in life, he doesn't care if he lives or dies as long as he gets those who were responsible. It does,
right.
It's just, it doesn't matter about whatever, at that point, and that happens a lot with these movies, is what happens to them doesn't matter anymore, living or dying, as long as they their revenge mission.
Exactly. They have nothing. And that's a big part of it, is they have nothing left to lose because they've basically been killed. They're almost, it's almost like they've been killed. And this is another thing in revenge movies, which I think of as the Phoenix story, where the person is completely destroyed. And then rises from the ashes to come back and enact revenge. And this is often not necessarily revenge. Okay, a good movie example of this is The Revenant.
Yeah, but I mean, I guess that's a different. He's just revenge. Well, no, because he has to avenge them. I don't think he would have minded them leaving him for dead.
Right.
It's that they killed his son.
Right. Okay, you're right. Yeah.
Yeah, and that's what really fuels him and drives him to survive. And go through all the perils.
And go through all the perils.
Because he needs revenge against what they did to his son.
But you're right. But he is left for dead. Yeah. So I guess maybe a better example would be like Kill Bill or even I Spit on Your Grave.
Interesting you brought up I Spit on Your Grave. So, Kill Bill, that was sort of like Tarantino's own little fantasy. Why I put that in a completely different box. Yes, female wronged and is coming back for revenge. But her profession, just like John Wick,
right, yes,
was an assassin.
Yes.
And so they have skills that the ordinary man doesn't have. Now, when you talk about I Spit on Your Grave, there's another film that I only saw a few years ago. And I stayed away from it because of the subject matter. I'd heard it was so brutal. I mean, I'm not interested in seeing a movie that really festers a long time on rape scenes.
Right.
And this is what I was interested in. My wife had seen it. She loved the movie. She likes horror movies and thrillers, and it was the first time I heard, and this is when I went down a whole rabbit hole of finding out that in the years that this movie has existed, for 40 years, it has developed a new take. Women saying, we're going to reclaim the story of being abusive women and saying that it is woman empowerment, because after suffering such horrific atrocities from this group of thuggy men, and not just once, but in two of the most brutal, too long, for my opinion, torturous rape scenes I've ever seen put on film.
Yes,
right. And so that should be enough. And you talk about the Phoenix rising from the ashes. She's basically a dead person.
Well, that's exactly what I'm talking about. Is they come back as basically a dead person, and they're almost a force of nature. There's something superhuman about them when they come back, in a way. And they have nothing left to lose. Everything has been stripped from them. And I think I Spit on Your Grave is like that. And it's you're right that it is being reclaimed as like a female empowerment story.
Yeah, there's a lot. I mean, again, I can see women watching this and saying, "This, I can't believe I was forced to watch this movie." And then I thought that my wife take was very interesting, that she looks at it as female empowerment, that she rises from the ashes and she goes out on revenge, and it's a revenge that is so deserved.
Exactly.
And again, we could go into these various buckets.
Okay, while we're on this particular...
I like the idea of like the female protagonist getting revenge.
Yeah, the female protagonist getting revenge, and there's a movie, and it's called Revenge, French film from 2017, 2018 in the U.S., and it's a Phoenix story like I Spit on Your Grave, with a woman who's basically the mistress for a billionaire, and he has some friends over, and she is raped and left for dead and rises from the ashes and comes back and goes after these men. She's not somebody who is a trained killer beforehand, but she kind of turns into this superhuman, almost over the top, like a Rambo type character, or like a killer Laura Croft. And what's interesting about this movie, and many things are interesting about this movie, is it's directed by a woman.
Which doesn't happen very often in the revenge drama.
It really does. I mean, I actually can't think of another one.
Some people point to Karen Kasama's Jennifer's Body, but I thought that movie was terrible, so let's not talk about it.
So Coralie Fergia directed this movie, and I liked it quite a bit. It is highly stylized. It almost at times looks like a Michael Bay movie, just in terms of that like really glossy cinematography. But I will a couple of things about this movie. The rape scene in this movie is handled in a really different way than you would normally see in a revenge movie. And it goes back to this emasculation thing that you were talking about, where she, well, I don't know. I don't want to get too into the details of the scene, but it's really well played and it's done in a way that men don't do, right? And then when she dies and she comes back and she's totally impaled, she doesn't die, but I mean, figuratively dies. When she comes back, she the way she is viewed, the way she's photographed, empowers her body in a different way than a male director would look at the female body.
Interesting.
Yeah, and so I don't know. This to me is a female empowerment revenge film, and I think if you're if you're interested in the gender and sexual politics around revenge films, this is a must see.
Well, I definitely want to check it out when possible. Just a couple other quick movies. I don't think we have to really get into them in terms of Mandy, but movies that reminded me. When I was watching Mandy, there's the classic couple. There are almost two movies that have the same plot, where innocent families in a camper van and they are taunted and abused, yes, by either psycho cults or hippie gangs. Is Race with the Devil, which is Warren Oates,
yep,
and him and his happy family are getting tortured by Peter Fonda, I think,
yes,
and some bad guys. And then The Hills Have Eyes, which, yes, is a classic everybody's seen. And Mandy, they're not in a van, but there's a group of psycho cults that kind of traveling in a van. So I think that there's a connection that the director is tying into those films. And when we talk about those, the emasculating moments, there's an interesting twist in this film in their sort of central scene before the revenge happens, that it kind of flips the script a bit and it gives the chance for a female to have a moment.
Yes.
And the female in this film, the sort of counterpart to Nicolas Cage, is she's a European actress. I don't know if she's British or Welsh or whatever, but it's Andrea Riseborough.
Yes.
And I've seen her in a ton of movies. I love her. She's a great character actress. And there's some interesting decisions that are made about her character.
Yes.
She's sort of a chameleon, but she's wearing like contact lenses that changes her eyes.
Right.
She has kind of a weird, mysterious scar on her face.
Yes.
That is never explained.
Yes.
Other than maybe something was cut out, because I do know they've cut out a lot of stuff in the film.
I actually like that the scar is never explained, because it just makes her seem vulnerable, but also as though she's been through stuff and is tough.
Yeah, and of course, the film only works as if there's something about her that's so mysterious and cool that she's going to catch somebody's attention.
Exactly.
Which, on screen, she does. Like, I bet you there's a lot of people don't know who she is. They'll look at her and,
yeah,
say, who is this actress? And that's key, because she catches the eye of a psycho cult family.
Again, why I like the long setup. I like spending all that time with her.
I had issues with Mandy at the beginning, but then once those issues got put aside and things got rolling, it's a thrill ride.
Yeah.
It's a great musical score by a guy who's dead now, is Johan Johansson.
Oh, we haven't even talked about the music, but
the music is fantastic. There's so much to like, people. Get to this.
There's
movie.
So much to like, but you know, this is funny. Like when I, you know, because I watched that first 15 minutes, so I knew what to expect in terms of the pacing, so I wasn't impatient with it the second time. But one thought I had the second time through watching the opening credits again was, if you aren't into the music and the font of the credits, you're not going to like this movie.
No, I mean, you said you couldn't necessarily recommend this to anybody. And it's weird to love a film, and we're talking about this movie for now 40 minutes, and we can't necessarily recommend it to a lot of people.
Right. It's a really, you just have to know what you're getting into, I guess. And you have to be up for something that's, let me say this about this film. Movies are a visceral experience. We don't experience them the way we do when we read, where it's through thought. We experience them through our senses, through our eyes and our ears. And so we have an immediate visceral reaction to the images and the sounds. Some movies don't exploit that aspect of cinema. Mandy really does. It's a audio visual visceral experience that engages the senses. And so it almost can't be completely talked about because it needs to be experienced. And so it's not about the plot. It's not about the acting. It's not about the cinematography. It's about the experience of sitting there and letting this movie take you someplace that movies don't usually.
I can tell you that if, say, this movie had come out in 1983... I would have discovered it on video. As a matter of fact,
yes.
I was thinking of this film is that I kind of would like, it should have been like an extra, that they would have done a pan and scan for VHS version of it where you don't even get to see part of the stuff and it would be experienced the way I would have had to have watched it on video and still enjoyed it because it just, it is just, again, you could have, and this is a movie that is shot 2.35 in that Panavision anamorphic look. And he uses the frame correctly.
Yes, he knows. Well, I got to say, this guy has vision. I saw his first film, Beyond the Black Rainbow, which came out in 2010. It is also a visionary work. Yes, maybe not entirely successful at times, but this guy is not afraid to put it out there.
I want to see that movie, and now I'm a fan, and I want Panos Cosmatos to make more films.
I know. I can't believe it was 8 years between these two movies.
You know, that's what my wife said that. She's like, well, why? And I said, well, you know, that movie, I didn't even hear about it, and I only heard about it because of this film. And the way the film market is today, the movies, like this movie, Mandy, would never have been a huge blockbuster.
Right.
However, it would have been like, in the boneyard time of movies where when we were growing up, like either right before the Christmas films or more likely in the winter time before the summer films, all sorts of weird crap would come to my multiplex. This movie would have come there and played for a few weeks and it would have been kind of a cool cult movie.
Yeah.
And now these films don't even get a release. Well, as a matter of fact, the whole reason why, not that he would have gotten nominated for an Oscar anyway for his score, but there was a lot of push to hopefully get Johan Johansson a nomination for the Mandy score. However, it was a day and date. It got released in any theaters it was going to get released in, the same as video on demand. It didn't have a 1 week qualifying run, so they said no.
Okay.
And so this is what it is. This movie today, it gets made knowing, and that's probably a wide decision. They're saying, I'm not going to give you money to shoot this on film when it's just going to go on demand and no one's going to see it in a theater.
Yeah. Mandy currently has an 81 on Metacritic. So, you know, this movie was well received by critics.
Yeah. I'm bummed as I had, because after you said you got to go see it, I couldn't online. I actually could have paid a lot of money to watch it, but it was in Redbox up the street and I got it for $2, but it was only a DVD copy. So I even missed out on a little of the vibrancy
that
I might've got with a Blu-ray or seeing it on, you know, streaming at 1080.
Right.
As a matter of fact, I think I would own a 4K ultra high def version of this film.
Oh, I totally would. Yeah.
So anyways, you know,
Okay, wait, one last revenge film I want to throw in here. One of my favorites is Blue Ruin from 2013.
Oh, yeah, you know what? After you told me about this, I went to look. It's not available for free
on
any of my services.
It used to be a couple of years ago.
I did watch the trailer and I'm with you. It looks great.
Yeah, it's great and it mixes up the genre a little bit in the sense that the violent event took place years before the movie even starts. And so you don't see that. What you see is somebody who for years has been traumatized by that and has been waiting for revenge until the perpetrator gets out of prison.
Yeah, that sounds cool.
Yeah, and it's really cool. And another cool thing I like about this movie is that the main character does not turn into a killer. I mean, he does, of course, because he's on a revenge trip, but he doesn't turn into a highly proficient killer. He's actually totally incompetent all the way through the movie. Like, can't figure out how to use a gun. It's just, yeah. And so it's really well directed by Jeremy Saulnier. So anyhow, Blue Ruin is worth checking out. A revenge movie.
All right. Well, you know, we spent a lot of time talking about revenge films, and so hopefully you like revenge films. And, and if you don't, you can always write to us at feedback@jimandteal.com. But actually, also, you know, one of the things is we know how many people are listening to the show as far as numbers, but yeah. what we don't always know is who is listening to the show.
Yes.
And we have a good idea, you know, people that we know, but if you are somebody that is listening to the show who knows that we don't know you at all and you've just somehow stumbled upon it or, you know, or just found us and liked it, please send us a message so we yeah. know that some stranger out there is enjoying the program.
Yeah, and we also, you know, we'll take suggestions.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yep.
Throw us a subgenre and we'll talk about it.
Yep. As you can see, we like to go down the rabbit hole. All right. Well, until next time, we will talk to you later. Signing off now.
Bye-bye.
Bye.